Welcome to Singapore, a country like no other. A country where buildings are modelled before the construction to take into account all the properties of the soil and the direction of the tropical wind, and where land is created from the ground up if necessary. A country where vegetables and fruits are grown in vertical farms because it is simply impossible to cultivate them any other way. And all this without sunlight and proper soil. A country that, on one hand, processes rainwater to make it drinkable, and on the other hand, is the world leader in GDP per capita without having rich natural resources. And in this super progressive country where only 56 people have died during the entire pandemic, lockdowns are now cancelled. Cases of infection are no longer counted and COVID is viewed as ordinary flu.
While accepting that some people may get infected every now and then, just as we do with a common flu or dengue fever,
Singapore has advanced in this matter so far that it's shifting its perception of the coronavirus pandemic to a coronavirus endemic. That is, treating the global epidemic, which has been instilling fear all over the world, as something that is just out there and can be dealt with. The first thing they did was admit that the virus isn't going anywhere, that the coronavirus is the new normal.
One day, this global pandemic will subside, but I do not expect COVID-19 to disappear. It will remain with humankind and become endemic. The virus will continue to circulate in pockets of the global population for years to come.
These were the words of the Prime Minister of Singapore, who posts videos on his YouTube channel more often than we do on our English and Russian channels combined. About once a week, he gets in touch with the nation and sometimes sheds some light on how people will live in the future. He is the Prime Minister from and for the people, and he speaks like regular folk. And just recently, he announced a plan to tackle the COVID pandemic as a flu-like challenge. You know that most of the population go through flu fairly well, and relatively few people require hospitalization, but for a minority, especially among the seniors or those with an underlying medical condition, the illness can become fatal.
Wait a second, Bony. Didn't you criticize comparing corona with the flu? Did you pull a 180 or get paid by someone?
I still condemn it because comparing it with the flu carried the message of don't do anything and let it slide. But in the case of Singapore, several actions are being taken. And the first mandatory step, which has made everyone sick already, is the total vaccination of the country.
We will vaccinate more people and faster. COVID-19 vaccinations will not entirely prevent you from getting COVID-19. But the vaccinations make this much less likely. And if you do get sick despite being vaccinated, you are also much less likely to become very ill.
So, if you want to be a developed country, you gotta act like one. At the time of making this video, 83% of the Singapore population has taken the first dose, and 79% received the second. Let us show you the current numbers. By the end of September, they plan to complete the full chipization of their citizens. But how does Singapore know that coronavirus can be dealt with like flu? They just took a note from Israel, the most vaccinated country at the moment. There were 0.3 cases of hospitalization among the vaccinated people, against 4.6 cases among the unvaccinated ones per 100,000 citizens. It means that the vaccine reduces the likelihood of hospitalization by about 15 times. When it comes to lethal cases, it is 0.1 against 0.6. So the vaccine reduces the likelihood of death by at least 6 times. Keep in mind that these steps were taken with Israeli healthcare system in place. And this is another answer to the question of why vaccinations are needed. Now let's take the hospitalization and death rates among vaccinated people and compare them with the numbers for adverse flu cases in the United States. If we take the 2018 to 2019 period, we'll be looking at 0.4 and 0.03 respectively. So figures for corona and flu are pretty close, and they become even closer if we consider stats for severe epidemics of 2017 to 2018, which was 0.67 and 0.05 respectively. So the Singapore authorities looked at these numbers and were like, "All right then, time to get a fix, people." Now let me make a small remark. At the time when I was finishing the script for this video, Singapore got struck with the Delta strain of the virus, and the numbers of cases has risen significantly, well, at least by their standards. However, we need to look at this graph. Even though there was an increase of new infections, the number of hospitalizations among vaccinated is still tiny, 0.7%, and none of the lethal cases. So Singapore still proves that their tactic works quite well. On top of that, revaccination may be required to reinforce protection against new strains. Singapore tackles the issue very seriously, and they are already developing a multi-year vaccination program. In the last video, where I was considering getting a shot of Sputnik, our Russian viewers wondered why would those who got vaccinated or recovered need to do it again. Remember, we said that antibodies are snipers who shoot down the virus on the come up. However, these snipers are not always on alert. Over time, they die off. Moreover, the data on antibodies is somewhat inconsistent right now. Nobody knows exactly how much of each type is needed against a certain strain. It is further complicated by the fact that the methods for analyzing the numbers of antibodies vary, but they are working on it. And the current notion is that in order to keep snipers on alert, revaccination is required every 6 to 12 months. So the Singapore authorities do not just treat COVID like flu, they do so under the condition of total vaccination and future revaccination. But that's not all. The approach to infection testing is changing. First, the process itself should become more comfortable than scratching your brain with a long cotton swab. And secondly, it should show results in less than a couple of days. That's why quick adoption of antigen tests is underway instead of PCR tests. Sure, they still require sticking something in your nose, but it's not so deep and you get the results in half an hour. And there are also breathing tests that are great all around. You exhale, wait a minute and get the verdict. Essentially, they work like breathalyzers. Such tests will be used everywhere, at the border control, in restaurants, and in pharmacies. Moreover, there are discussions about free access to these tests. That way, you'll be able to do it at your own will. If your quick test is positive, you do a PCR test and wait a couple of days for the result. If it is positive too, you isolate yourself at home. But what happens if a sick person goes into public without knowing it? They can reinfect everyone around them, right? Well, this is where the Big Brother comes in. If you thought that only China is building digital totalitarianism, you were wrong. Sooner or later, we'll all get there. Singapore has a Trace Together app with 5 million connected users, which is 92% of the population. This app reads IDs of all mobile users nearby via Bluetooth. If there is a sick person, it sends an alert to those who pass them by. With this kind of system, chipization won't be needed. Our Russian friend, Maxim Chernov, who lives in Singapore and is an expert in social media marketing, confirmed this information and told us a lot of interesting things. He sent us screenshots of the app, which shows the status of the vaccination. On the screenshot, you can see in progress, which changes to fully vaccinated 14 days after the second injection. This app is also used as an entrance ticket of sorts when you go to a shopping mall or restaurant. By the way, if you were in close contact with a sick person for 20 minutes, then they will call you and take you to a special hotel for isolation. All of it is done at the expense of the state. Damn, it makes me wonder what such forced isolation would look like in Russian reality. And if you just walked past an infected person, you'll receive a notification saying that you should carefully monitor your condition. Something similar was introduced in Moscow in 2020, when restaurant goers were required to show a QR code. And if one of the visitors fell ill, other guests were notified that they were in a high-risk area. If you experienced something like that where you live, tell us about it in the comments. But in general, whatever you call it, the point of all these measures is to notify people as quickly as possible and, of course, monitor their location. So, COVID can be perceived as flu only after implementing a set of measures which include universal vaccination and revaccination, wide access to quick tests, isolation in case of RV symptoms and a positive PCR test, contact tracing through apps, and focusing public attention on stats for hospitalizations and deaths. Singapore is heavily dependent on international trade, and therefore it is doing everything in its power to bring things back to normal, albeit with some limitations, of course. I would like to note one more thing. Our Russian viewers said,
"Our government has been doing nothing for the people, but now all of a sudden they started to care about our health for free. Yeah, right."
And I totally agree with that. The state has been doing nothing, but people misread the motive. Firstly, the fact that people don't pay for vaccines doesn't mean that they're free. In our case, there is a compulsory medical insurance policy, which means that the health insurance fund pays for vaccines. That's why you are required to bring this policy for vaccination. Secondly, the sooner a country is vaccinated, the sooner it will return to normal life, revitalize its economy, and boost international trade. In this case, human health is just a business. A frozen economy and weak trade are simply not profitable. So, don't overestimate your importance. All this is just business, in which vaccination rate is merely another competitive advantage for a country. That's all. And thirdly, not only our immune system learns to fight the virus, but also states. And right now they are accumulating experience, conducting research, and selecting effective methods that will be used in the future. Remember, the coronavirus isn't going anywhere. Get ready for the future, ladies and gentlemen, and get ready with us. Hit that like button, subscribe to the channel, and share this video with your friend. And I'm Bony Wright.